Taka Aono is... That's a good question. Let me try to think about this. There's so many expletives I can use.
Taka Aono is old.
The hardcore AE86 bastard.
Probably the best driver of the AE86 in the United States.
Dedicated? That's the only thing I can think of with Taka.
Taka is drifting passion. He motivates me.
Taka Aono is a true warrior. There you go. I like that one.
Basically, everybody out here loves him. Everybody wants to see him succeed and do good.
The most dedicated driver in Formula Drift, hands down.
Taka is the spirit of drifting, for sure.
Taka Aono is Hachirobe.
Taka Aono is... Flying 86.
My name is Taka Aono. I'm competing in the Toyota Corolla in the Formula Drift. I'm originally from Japan, Nagano, Japan. I moved in to the States back in 1990 in Omaha, Nebraska. I went to college over there. I liked the mechanical things, you know. To learn English, for me, it was a car. My first car was 71 Volkswagen Beetle. But, you know, those cheap cars, I had to fix it. At the same time, I didn't speak good English, so things I was doing is reading factory manual, and went to those repair shop, ask question, but they're busy, so I tried to get it at once, and those things helped me in the English part a lot. And yes, you know, since then, the car was part of my things, I guess. And one day I was driving around, I found 64 Karmann gear sitting on the grass. It looked like the car grew up from the ground. The customer disappeared, so it's a lean sale. And it was really bad. But yeah, I liked the shape. And back in Omaha, it's so hard to find those Karmann gear. Yeah, I talked to the body shop guy. You know, I got the car for free, but you know, I have to help them at the shop, start doing the restorations. And I pretty much did get the show car. But car show was not my thing. I realized that. I hope I don't offend some people, but go there, drop off the car. From, I would say, 9, 10 o'clock on, you just sit and wait till end of the show. Most exciting part for me was go to swap meet. That was fun part. Playing the car to put the engine together and those things was fun. But, you know, as far as bringing car to the car show and those things was like, yeah, done. But, you know, one of my friends was doing SEC autocross. He asked me, like, hey, yeah, bring the car down. Well, you know, the car was modified, bigger engine, you know, suspension to lower the car. So, you know, I take it. And it was fun. Just 3 runs, but it was something different. So I started liking it. Then I went to one of the racing shop, and I asked them, hey, I want to do the road race. What to do? First thing they ask is, do you have money? Like, I said, no. Okay, you have a car, yeah. Okay, go to SCCA Solo 2 autocross. And you know, just get the national champion some class, and you're ready for autocross. He said like that, so I thought that's very simple things to do. So I started doing the autocross, the SCCA. 1 year, one of my friends who drove the Volkswagen convinced me to go Solo 2 national, and I didn't know how serious people were. And when we got there, of course, it's super modified car anyway. So you have to run against crazy, super modified car built for the purpose car, and I got last place. But I was first year, so SCCA sent me that nice mug. See you next year. Thank you for coming. Like, oh, thank you. Then I realized I didn't like to have an excuse of bad car, so I decided to buy stock class car. So I call around and got 93 MR2 turbo. Pretty much, I asked those national champions back in the B stock what setup I have to run. So, only excuse I have is my driving. I decide my goal to be 300-mile radius. So if I have to drive 300 mile to run the Solo 2, I decide to go there. So I start running all the Midwest. So, I'm only like stupid Asian dude in Midwest, showing up everywhere. And I got the divisional champions, but at the national, I was having a tough time. But I had to come to California for the chiropractic school, start getting into the local autocross and Southern California scene, and where I met a lot of the Japanese autocross car people, including Moto, Kenji from G-Speed. Back then, still, I was driving MR2. One day, we went to Willow Springs with Moto and everybody. Moto was actually borrowing the A86 from Toy Sports. Back then, Moto's borrowing is like, pretty much he's keeping it. So he put whatever suspension he wanted. He didn't touch the engine. And I was running MR2 in the street of Wiro, but it was hot in the summertime, and the car gets hot. Every three laps or so, I had to do cool down, and I was not having fun. And the Moto offered me, you want to drive? And then, I jumped in the car. Back then, Type R Integra was a hot thing, so there were three or four of them running. With the Corolla, I could catch up with them. It's like, wow, this is fun car. And when you make a mistake, it shows up in time really good. So it's a rewarding car, too. And I really liked that. I was really shocked to see how well that thing handled. That was the actual beginning of modifying A86 things. Project itself started the end of year 2000. After I drove Moto's car at the Willow Springs, I started talking to Moto about the possibility winning national championship in autocross. The idea was latest year 85 GTS. As long as it's a GTS Corolla, it was okay. And we could go high comp motor from A92. We got the car, Signal Auto, a fairly cheap 1500. And Kenji Sakai from G-Speed did the engine rebuild, which is just changing bearing. Engine already had over 100,000 miles, but we didn't have money to spend. So all year 2001, we just doing a little bit of, swapping spring and those things. 2002, we decided to go nationally with A86 and a class called FSP. I was driving in open class. My girlfriend Yoshie was driving ladies' class. Moto volunteered to be tire warmer. Hiro Sumida back then was driving Subaru in a street tire class. So all of those guys went to Topeka, Kansas to compete. We had over 40 cars in our class. The level of competition over there is amazing. It's kind of weird to see a bunch of people driving the same category class and over 120 seconds. You get difference of some class, like thousands, decide the winning. We won by about 2/10 over 120 seconds. So it was fairly close. Took me 8 years to get it. So, and at the same time, Moto started organizing event with Naoki Kobayashi, and it's called like Drift Day. But drifting was so new, a lot of people hated it. Back then, Speed Trial had a session for drifters. And 80% of them were just spinning all over the place and then making mess everywhere. And those people who are doing time attack, they hate us, right? I was helping Moto, and Moto and Naoki decided to use a parking lot event at Irwindale. Then, of course, we watch option video and those things, so I knew what the drifting was. But it wasn't for me because it's slower. And it's for sure car control, but when you're doing time attack, when you put more than this much counter steer, you made a mistake. And I think 2003, Japanese Sampros, who shoot the Ikaten video, contact Moto and Naoki to have a Los Angeles version of Ikaten, amateur competitions. Moto asked me to help set up the course at Darwindale parking lot. And Nomken showed up and he borrowed the car from Signal and did the actual drifting. And that thing was amazing. Back then, we didn't have any safety standard for the spectating or anything. Miyamoto and Naoki were sitting on the K-rail, and Nom came coming from backside and coming in and face us. For sure, we had eye contact. And Nom came start coming this way after a transition and grazed by K-rail. Since we're sitting in the K-rail, we have about this much to the car. Yeah, of course, we run away after that. And the amount of the wind the car create, it's actually amazing because car was not meant to go sideways. The wind blows like pfft. For me, that was the first time I see actual drifting. It was exciting to see, and I wanted to do it. At the same time, RSR wanna bring the Orido and debut their shop on the US side by having drifting contest in the Awindale. Originally, it was designed to be done at the parking lot. But when me and Moto went to our window to talk about possible, you know, dates, layouts, and those things, the management guy said, why don't you use the inside? Yeah, and then we decided to use the infield of the actual bank course for the RSR things. And that was a huge success. Then, because of sample relation from Ikaten, they decided to bring the D1 in the USA. And then things really exploded afterward. As far as I remember, Slipstream Global and D1 GP had a little bit conflict of interest. Slipstream Global side was wide open to have a D1 in the USA, but D1 Japan's gonna get exclusive for lots of things because main thing was video sale. So yeah, things didn't go well. And I think back then Jim and Ryan decided to have own American things. I got lucky that Drift Day had a relationship with Yokohama and the Falcon Tires. And the Hero got sponsored by Falcon Tire, and I got sponsored by Yokohama Tire. So yeah, Moto and Naoki create Team Drift Association. And we decide to start traveling. A few weeks later, we go in Formula D. First year, all the judges are Japanese driver. And the level of the driving technique against the judges was so different. Utsumi, Koguchi, and Seigo were the three judges. And pretty much those three drivers show us how to do it. But back then, we didn't know anything. And every event, the driver's meeting is demonstration, pretty much. And changes came in 2005. One big criteria for judging was you consider the capability of the car. If driver is getting 100% out from the car, that's good. So like our indoor event, even D1, some car like SR20, like 300-400 horsepower has to initiate the bank from the beginning. But you know, the Corolla, it's impossible, so we could initiate later. And those things are okay. But the popularity of drifting itself, we start getting more spectator who doesn't know anything about cars. And for them, you know, why are those cars doing that? Other cars start drifting early, and those things, you know, getting in the way. From my point of view in the United States, fairness is more important things. So it's getting more fair for everybody. It's just the biggest difference in Japanese D1 style and the American style is in D1, it was, okay, let's put the better show for the spectator. So, you know, they usually respect each other on the start. They never do the drag race, actually. They always look at each other, wait for each other. And US side, among the drivers, they are good friends. But the big sponsor came in, they have to win. Winning is everything. When it comes down to that, you know, like gentleman's rule somehow disappear, and people start doing a lot of nasty tricks, each other. And those things we are seeing a lot in the American side. And I just really hate seeing those things. Well, you know, when the big money involved, your job is to win, whatever the way. But, you know, as spectators start getting bigger, 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 and, you know, they have to change it, too. They want to see tandem like this. They don't want to see two cars running, you know, like so much apart, it's boring. When you start focusing on tandem, then, you know, makes power and torque more favor than technique itself. That's when we start seeing less A86 because it's not cheap anymore. It's cheaper to go SR20 or V8. Easier to drive and easier to get power out of it. Last few years, we keep losing Corolla people and only stubborn enough people to drive was me and John Rasakoff. And we always say the same thing. End of the year, we need 50 more horsepower, 50 more horsepower, 50 more horsepower. And John and myself, we never thought we're gonna drive over 400 horsepower Corolla. But yeah, that's where we are.
started off with an 86, driving an El Mirage, right? With your pops. And now you're driving for freaking Toyota Scion.
Yeah, so what's interesting is that I started off in a Corolla, like you mentioned. In between, I've driven many parts from the S13, the Ford Mustang, some RX-7s here and there, and I'm back in FRS after driving TC. So driving a car that carries the same heritage, you know, obviously, I couldn't be any happier.
It holds a sentimental value to me. This is actually the first car that I started drifting in, and it's a car that my dad taught me basic car control, driving, everything. I pretty much started my career in an 86, and I'm actually still building one myself. Besides my Scion FRS, but I also have a 1985 Toyota Corolla. It's simply a driver's car.
It's a total different car than most people are used to. It rotates around the driver and it has such an original feel to it. People fall in love driving that car. I fell in love driving that car.
When you look at it, it's somewhat archaic car by modern standards, but what makes it great is a great learner's car. Its simplistic nature allows you to kind of play with it. Everything you do to it is going to have a dramatic effect on it. It doesn't have a lot of power, so you have to force yourself to become a faster driver. Like they say, anyone can be fast in a fast car, only really good people can be fast in a slow car. And that's kind of how it works with the A86 as well.
There's definitely faster cars out there. There's definitely cars that turn faster lap times and have more power and whatnot, but the A86 is just the most fun thing to drive ever. Ever been competitive. The car itself is not competitive. No matter how much money you seem to dump into it, it always seems underpowered.
It's the style of drifting has changed. The original style of drifting are like solo laps and looking cool. It used to be more about, you know, your own car. It's about how well you drive your car against other people. Puts it at a big disadvantage.
We've seen a significant number of V8 swaps. Anything from S13s with V8s, RX-7s with V8s. It's basically a race, you know. It's whoever has the most money invested into the car and who has the most power. And V8s are easy, cheap power.
It's the nature of competitive racing. Once the formula comes out and what's going to allow you to perform better, that's how it progresses. That's what happens with GT Touring racing and NASCAR and Formula One and everything else. It all comes down to the formula that works.
With any form of professional motorsports, you got to have a class where it's definitely more progressive than the rest of the field. If you keep limiting our builds and horsepowers to these amateur spec levels, then we're not going to have professional drivers. We're not going to have a professional series where thousands and thousands of fans can come to watch you drift.
When I start helping Moto and Naoki, since our background is SCCA autocross, our goal is make the drifting big enough so that it's sustained by itself, not controlled by trends or anything, just like autocross. Over 50,000 people does it nationwide. If we have bigger base, the top portion sustained by itself, just like a NASCAR, make a big fan base, a lot of amateur drifters and pro-am on top. But US drifting it started like this. A lot of pro and not much support in the middle and not much spectator. And nowadays it's getting bigger on this portion, but still not enough amateur drifters around. Formula D, level of the competition jumps so much compared to some pro-am series, even bigger gap now. At first, you know, usually when you get license, you don't have any tire support. So you have to buy tire, and you have to travel to compete. Let's say shooting for the Rookie of the Year, you have to do all 7 or 8 events. You have to modify your car to catch up with 800 horsepower V8 car, or 1200 horsepower 2J car. And you know, those things discourage amateur people. All right, I got a license, what am I gonna do? For ordinary people, it's too expensive to deal with it. And those things, are you really worried that that might kill the drifting itself? The competition drifting, one thing is hugely different. One mistake, you're out. You don't have next lap to catch up. It's only one shot, only 2-3 turns. So if you build a car that's easy to drive, it's forgiven to you. If you have like a mid-range torque, that's when you can drive easy. Like when I'm driving, let's see, this car, 1.6 turbo, I had to keep everything above 6,000 RPM. In the Long Beach, I use first, second, third, initiate third, downshift second, downshift first, up to shift second. While, you know, I try to catch up with, you know, e-brake and those things. But when you start driving V8 or more torque car, start with the second gear, upshift start, you leave it. You don't have to downshift upshift. It's a lot less things to worry about. So, you know, that's why people are choosing it. And it's cheaper to make torque. Not the power, that's the key word, torque. Drifting car needs to be reliable and easy to drive and easy to maintain. And all those three things is in the V8. So here's the take, right? Drifting was a JDM sport. So you want to see people driving JDM car, and you see people putting American V8s. And it's like not really drifting. Some people say that, though the purists, I think. And there are drifters who want to win, but they have to make at least 300, 400 foot-pound torque in mid-range, 4,000 RPM. And what the choices? If you are really a drifter who want to win, then you go with a trend. Some very creative guy got the idea, did their own research, checked the weight, what the possibility of horsepower outcome, does it fit? And it did. Good for you. Here you go. I have nothing against it. But, you know, for me, it's not showing respect to the manufacturer in a professional level. I don't think the Mustang fan appreciate LS1 in the Mustang. A Corvette guy in a Ford engine, it doesn't work like that, right? Yeah, I'm not getting any factory sponsorship from Toyota. I don't know, like maybe they don't even know A86 is running. You know, I appreciate what they make. It's a fun car to drive. A lot of people think maybe I'm a purist, but I seriously consider size of V8 too. But I couldn't put it in here. Then some people talk about, you know, 1UZ, Toyota V8. Why not? That 1UZ engine can make a lot of power, but not torque. To make, you know, American V8 torque, you have to turbo it. And then that kind of defeat the purpose. So that's how I take it. When we start, you know, thinking about graduating from 4AG, that was 2010. And I was looking for any power plant. And then I saw RSR team doing 2AZ. That thing makes 670 horsepower and over 500 foot-pound torque. And it keeps more than 300 foot-pound torque from 3,000 up. So that's a lot of torque. And they didn't have any issue with engine. So it's good engine. I asked them, and they helped me a lot to develop the engine program. So I decided to go with 2AZ to play with the V8 people. Yeah, and well, we had an issue with the engine build side, so I ended up driving 4AG car all year long in 2011. That was tough. You know, this 4AG one, the turbo makes over 400 horsepower, but 260 foot-pound torque. Somebody slow down in front of me, I'm done. I can downshift so much. Finally, we got a 2AZ engine and 2012. And when it's running good, it's like amazing. You don't have much issue catching up people. But we had a lot of issue. And we never had time to develop the suspension to catch up with the torque and horsepower. I wish, you know, like we have time and money to develop the suspensions. And the car itself, I think it's really possible. Lightweight with a lot of horsepower. That's the idea why we are doing this. I don't know, like a lot of people don't have experience driving 400, 500 horsepower Corolla. Those people should drive this car. It's totally different world. And you know, until you feel those, you know, you cannot actually say that this car is absolute. And too bad everybody gave up too early.
Safe to say you don't feel the Corolla is a handicap?
No. Well, Corolla is not handicap. Period.
Well, last Tuesday, we actually had a testing event, you know, kind of prepare for Irwin now. I guess Taka went out for a couple laps, and then next thing you know, engine problems. Taka made a few phone calls and started talking to World Racing guys, Chris Rado with the 1200 horsepower Asana TC. Apparently he had some extra motors that he's prepared, and they were happy enough to loan us a motor for this weekend. So it's a lease agreement. So we're all happy. Wow, we got this thing ready to go. Next you know, Thursday practice comes along. Basically on the first lap, we start noticing something strange. And looks like he blew a hand gasket. So it's really nice of Elise World Racing guys to come out and assess the problem and supply with the new motor. So right now, as of, where are we? 11:30, this new motor, it's being installed right now. And we're hoping to get this car running and ready for competition. You know, this situation just pretty much sums up our whole year. And that's the hardest part about it, is put a lot of effort into this car and motor. And instead of expecting results, we're expecting breakdowns. It'd be nice if we can have one great race weekend and sort of show what Taka is capable of. We have the formula right. Brand new motor built, 2AZ, 600 horsepower, brand new G-force transmission. He put a lot of thought into his build this year. He'll be here. I know Taka too well. And he'll get the car here in time, and he's gonna drive his ass off regardless. I'm hoping with all the bad luck he's had this year that he's gonna lay down some really good results. We've been at rock bottom for how many events?
Right.
We gotta go just slightly up, you know? Give us a top 16 at least once this year. That's all I'm asking.
Yeah.
One.
So good, but we only let it idle on the jack.
No.
Hopefully it'll work pretty good.
Good job.
Did you guys fix it? New motor?
Taka.
You know how it feels.
I do, yeah. I do. Oh, I'm glad you're here.
Without this guy, man.
You need a hug?
Yeah, I need a beer.
Good work.
I need a beer.
Are you just sore yet? Because, I mean, that's what I get after about 2 days, 3 days.
It's gonna be a little ashy because the engine's new. As it breaks in more, it's gonna seal up tighter and tighter. But we didn't even dyno it, you know, just came straight out here, so that's pretty good.
Oh, I got those.
Okay. Chris's biggest concern was that you guys, you know, at least made one successful run, so that's Chris and Rob's.
I would say we made more than one successful run.
Good.
You see his runs.
Yeah.
It's been a while since you've seen him commit the way he has. I'm gonna put the car right there on that clipping point. I'm gonna stick my ass in over against the wall, right about here. And it's been a while. It's been a long time. If Taka needs to give that extra 10% during qualifying, I think he's got it in him. So it's gonna be a good one. We'll be right back.
in a house, all she thinks about. No responsibility, no guilt, or morals, cloud or judgment. Smile on her face, she does what she damn well please. Right, and she don't care what kind of things people used to do. And she don't care that what you've done hasn't hurt on you. She's got freedom in the 21st century.
Taka Aono.
Daigo's got something. Yeah, to make that much, you know, like mid-range power and torque, you have to have a 1,200 horsepower, because power curve, his power curve is not like this. It's like this. What he's using here. In my car, this one makes 560, but most likely I'm using somewhere about 350 to 450 all the time. That's how you have to think about the power output. We can make 700-800 horsepower, but the power curve not gonna be like this. It's still getting like this. That's why we don't chase for the top end power. We call it the area under the graph is more important. Yeah. 1,200 horsepower is no secret. The way he can control the wheel speed is actually amazing. He's not using 1,200 horsepower all the time, but he can always use 600 horsepower. He's a wide guy, but yeah.
This was a surprise to me. I haven't hopped in and got a ride with any of these drivers for the past 5 years. The progression of these vehicles and the way they handle, it's really tough for an 86 to go out there and do some damage. It's just because the solid rear end, amount of power you can put out to the weight and the tires, everything comes down to it.
The way the sport's evolving, it takes some pretty serious stuff to be competitive. Without doing some serious changes and then trying to stay within the rule book, I don't think it's not real possible, I guess.
I still have a Corolla at home, you know? And, you know, I've been a Corolla driver for like 6 years. You know, I went on dates with them. I was driving around with no shirt because it's so hot. You're stuck in traffic for 4 hours and all that other stuff. But, you know, everybody's going to move on to something new, you know? Like, I'm running a 2J with whatever horsepower and something like that. And when everybody starts evolving, you know, everybody's going to have to bring in new cars and start to work on new technology for other cars and stuff.
You can kind of clean slate the thing and modern up the chassis a little bit, throw some cool stuff at it. I think it could be very competitive. With the way the rules are, you're real limited on what you can do.
With the restriction of the suspension, I believe if you went independent in the rear, that would help him greatly, you know. But if the vehicle is a solid rear end axle, you have to stick with it. Suspension pickup points could only be moved so much also. So he's done everything he can to try to lay it down.
It's difficult because it's such a lightweight chassis. And then to be competitive, you have to run quite a wide tire, which means your car needs to be like 2,800 pounds or something. And a Corolla is, you know, stripped out, it's 2,000 pounds, and you're not allowed to put weight in. So the rules were written, and no thought given to the little patchy rockers.
His car is obviously fast, makes a ton of power, and a lot of smoke, and looks good. So I wouldn't say that he has to move from that chassis in order to do better. He's put in the time and the effort, and if he had a stronger crew, I feel, he could really excel. The size of Taka's program, really relates to a lot of these grassroots guys, even though he has been in the sport for a very long time. He's always the guy wrenching on his own car, he's driving his own rig, and you see that when other drivers have to do that, they kind of have that same situation, just being just really overworked, and it's a lot more for a driver to stress about. You have to separate yourself from all the other things and only focus on driving.
You know, we have no weight room back home, so there's nothing better than a really nimble, lightweight chassis. It's my favorite type of vehicle to drive. It's a pity that the sport has kind of outgrown that car. It's almost impossible to be competitive, especially with a 4AG. I mean, that day is gone.
The last couple of years, Taka has been suffering with power. You know, even with the Hasselgren 4AG, as long as it's, you know, 1.6, there's so much power you can pull out of it. But now, you know, this year, with a 2AZ, I think 2.4, 2.5, he's pushing a lot more power, and with the extra displacement, you can get a good response. So I think it's competitive now.
I know that motor can do a lot because it's proven. You know, you have Chris Rado running it, you have Norwegian Hammer running one, and he's making 700, and he's very competitive. You just have to work on the car as far as trying to get that grip. Tires is a big issue. Getting to know the car more, because it totally acts different now. But if you put all of that together and make it work, and I know Taka will be able to do it, he will be able to be one of the top guys in Formula D like he used to be, because he's a good driver, and I know he has a lot of spirit, and I know he loves the sport. And if you have all of that combined with an amazing car, then I know he can make it up there.
So, Taka, what went wrong this weekend?
one-hour practice session, and it seems like car was kind of slow. Looking at the data log, we found the boost speed from the injector right before we go, actually. We were able to fix the issue. Daigo, his car is fast. I'm gonna jump on the start, so he's gonna pass me. But his car was way faster. Now I have to do the catch-up game. Now when I came in too fast, right here, hit. And I was on the full counter already. And the lower control arm adjuster broke. We called 5 minutes to repair it. Danny and Hiro worked on hard. We almost did it, but 5 minutes came. That's what happened today.
That's a tough question. Success. I found success in the fact that we got out there on the track. I found a certain amount of success in the fact that this is the last event of the year. We managed to attend every single one. How we do next year, I don't know.
Maybe it's just not enough anymore.
I've told him that for a long time.
Maybe it's something that's kind of kept him down for the last few years.
Taka can drive just about anything. It's his option to want to jump into something else. It's not us. We've been telling him for years he needs to give up.
He knows that car inside and out. You know, he might be more comfortable in his car, but at the same time, everybody's like, well, he's been in it for years and there's no results.
In all honesty, I think he'd probably be more competitive if he switched to a different chassis. The only thing is whether or not he'd be happy.
It's basically Taka equals AE86, so I hate to see him switch platforms, but you know, that's the funny thing is I can't picture Taka in any other car besides a Corolla.
It wouldn't be the same. You know, you're the Corolla guy, and he loves the chassis, he knows everything about it, every nut and bolt, and I'm sure he knows that with more development, it can be competitive and you can win. I think he wants to get to that point just to show everybody that, yes, this car can still do it. Don't take the easy road of jumping out onto a newer chassis. Keep working on what you know and love.
That car has legend, so there's got to be somebody that's going to keep that legend going.
He wouldn't feel right in any other car.
If I see him in an S chassis, my stomach all hurt. Knowing him, that's not what he wants. That is not what he wants to do. You know, he's a warrior. He's true to his car. He's going to figure out a way to make it work.
You know, Taka is still rocking the Hachi. I think there's a bit of a market there for that. You know, it's a complete classic gold car. It's just a pity that we only have one in the series, you know. It's something that needs to be more of them, you know. You could argue that without maybe the Corolla and the S13, there would be no drifters. So it's just a shame. I would love to be driving one, you know.
There's a couple of drivers that I read recently that said specifically that they could care less about going big or throwing angle or going smoke. They just want to move on to the next round and do tandem. But Taka is one of the few people that has the attitude that he'd rather go out there and put on a good show than necessarily have to move on every single time. Drifting is one of the motorsports that's unique in that you don't have to podium every single time in order to make a lasting impact on people. You just have to drive the right car, have the right attitude, and drive the right way, and Taka embodies all those things.
You have to have a certain amount of passion and a certain amount of stubbornness to continue driving this car and try to compete with those people out there. He could have easily done a lot of things to keep his name up on top, but he didn't. You don't always have to win to be a winner, you know? You don't always have to be first to be respected in this sport. That's one thing that makes Taka Taka.
And yeah, 2009. Falcon changed their strategy. They started aiming for the American Le Mans and the company image for more like car and driver pictures, not like an import tuner things, right? So yeah, they are aiming for newer car, and I got lucky enough to like buy this car. So I bought the car back from Falcon. We spent a lot of money just try to get car ready too. There's a few safety new regulations that I had to update it. And then after Long Beach, we had a question, like, how are we gonna make it East Coast? The way it looked like in the bank account, no way. And you know, Yoshie came up with the idea of donation. And we are like, maybe nothing gonna happen, but pretty much a lot of people amazingly, yeah, they donate their hard money for me to keep going. And we put their name on the car. Originally, it was only the roof, but wasn't enough space. So we expanded to rear window and even the hood. Since we are asking only for the East Coast event, we are just asking only end of April to end of May. And after May, I mean, in June, we still were getting email. I was really happy. And it was an amazing feeling that people helped me. This was most nerve-wracking year for me. But I was able to meet some of the people here. You know, like, oh, that's my name. And you know, took a picture, and that was, I don't know. I had a tough time that year, but a fun year too. I just have to thank them. Without them, you know, I won't be here. I really appreciate the people who trust the Corolla and still, you know, supporting me to be there. That's really amazing things. Now, throughout my career, I think we got really lucky. And somehow, you know, I'm stuck with the Club 4AG and the A86 world, and I'm good with that. I got lots of parts in my garage.
Straight from inside.